Hey everyone, this is Jay Nidar, aka SpideyFam101, and today I'm here to finally talk about Season 6 of X-Men the Animated Series. Now, my apologies, this is late. Obviously there's a lot going on in my life as Season 6 is going on, as you should probably know. College, job, all that stuff. That's why I didn't do episode reviews. Well, except for episode 5, but I'm here now. Classes are done. Semester's not until September. I have all this time to make videos for my channel. So let's do it. Now, for those who don't know, I've already made a video about the rest of the series and how much I love it and think it's definitive. And I already briefly talked about season 6 on the channel, not only in that video, but also in my video talking about episode 5. But because I never talked about it in its entirety, didn't do episode reviews besides that one because, I mean, have you seen episode 5? And now, that the season is done and I've had time to process it, I wanted to make a video talking about season 6 as a whole and my full thoughts on this season. Now, something that I feel is important to bring up here first and foremost is the fact that this season is the show brought back after 20 or so something years of being gone. And even though we've had an attempt at a continuation before, or this with X-Men 92, which is also great, I recommend, you know, everybody read that, it's a great continuation itself. This being the official continuation of the series, and it being done this well and this efficiently, cannot go without being addressed and being praised. So props to the showrunners, the voice actors, the animators, and most importantly to the writers that made this season as perfect as it turned out to be. And yes, I do think season 6 is a perfect season, even though I have personal nitpicks like the disgusting acts that were inflicted upon my girl Anne-Marie this season by Magnus. This season virtually had zero flaws in my opinion, and I thought that every aspect of this season was masterfully crafted. And it really took this show to the next level. Now, once again, you might be saying, stop kissing this show's boot! Again! What makes this season so undeniably perfect? Well, once again, it comes down to three factors. Number one, the story progression. This has to be one of the best story progressions in the show's entire history. The season was only 10 episodes long, about the same length as season 5, but infinitely better than season 5. And it didn't waste any time. From the first episode that lays the groundwork and really gives us the time to reunite with the characters we love, while at the same time secretly laying the groundwork for the story to come. To episode 2, which continues that trajectory and really starts to show the depths and almost darker themes that this season would later embrace. To episode 3 that leans into the whole messy situation that is Madeline Pryor and how her presence makes Scott and Jean's relationship dynamic harder. To episode 4, which leans into the kind of episodes I talked about in the previous video that shows the humanity of these characters, with Jubilee's birthday and her lesson of having to grow up and being okay with it, while at the same time hopefully finally killing Mojo. Hopefully. No more Mojo, please. And at the same time, showing Aurora's pain of losing her powers and trying to heal her wounds with Forge. To episode 5, which really tests my girl Anne-Marie and Remy's relationship. Adding that admittedly disgusting backstory between my girl Anne-Marie and Magnus, and showing that side of Anne-Marie during her villain era. The complexities that have come into her life because of what this triangle has presented, and having to choose between staying in X-Men or being the ruler of Genosha and standing for something greater. Like I said in the previous video, was great. For those who don't know, or didn't see the previous video, or haven't seen the trailer for my Big Four, the series, which is the first episode is coming up after this video, by the way. Before you come at me with Pitchfork Simpsons movie style again, I love Anne-Marie. And I love her for a plethora of reasons, but to put it in terms specific to this season, I love her because of how she has progressed and how willing she is to be of service and be the light to others that she couldn't have growing up. And this story that she's been given, having to choose between staying where she's been all this time and standing as the ultimate ambassador for mutant kind, was an excellent progression for her. And Lenora Zahn, man, dude, she's an absolute delight. Not only is she the definitive actress and voice for Anne-Marie, but in this season, season 6, this might be her best performance as my girl Anne-Marie. It's no secret Anne-Marie is my favorite character in this show and my favorite part of this season, but I had to say that she is all of those things once again. Breaking away from that tangent though, see, that's how you can tell that I'm biased toward my girl Anne-Marie. How Remy's arc as a character and everything he's done in the show's history really culminates in this season and this episode. His love for Anne-Marie, how he's changed since his days in the Thieves Guild, to his many years and adventures with the X-Men, and from this whole thing with Magnus this season. Everything culminated here. And this episode really makes you feel for Remy and how everything in his life that he cared about really started falling apart before his eyes. And his sacrifice made it even more sad. The fact that he died before Anne-Marie could tell him that she chose him, and the fact that the first time she got to really touch him gloveless was her touching his dead body. Take it away, Deadpool.
It's a total dick move.
Not to mention the stability of Genosha and what its inclusion in the United Nations meant for mutant kind, only for all of it to be upended and destroyed. This episode, perhaps out of all the episodes this season, really shows the dread of the situations going on and really shows you how the X-Men started to fall apart starting this episode. Not to mention how real this episode is, because for obvious reasons. To episode 6, that kind of puts Xavier in a bad but understandable light, mainly because we know Xavier and Lilandra had a bond in the earlier seasons during the Phoenix arcs, and the Shi'ar taking Xavier to heal him at the end of season 5 would inevitably lead to those feelings being brought out, but it didn't change the fact that he was supposed to come back once they healed him, but he didn't. And let's not forget how that episode also gave Aurora her powers back in the most amazing way. Her dealing with her anxieties, fears, and doubts, all in the form of the adversary, and overcoming them to become the most powerful and prime version of herself was absolutely incredible. To episode 7, which came out on my birthday, and thank you God for blessing me with an episode about my girl Anne-Marie on my birthday. It might have been a sad one, but I prayed for weeks at that point to know what was going on with my girl Anne-Marie, hoping she was okay, even though she obviously wouldn't be. But I took it, and it was a welcome birthday present, so thank you, God. I love you. But regardless, how episode 7 showed the after effects of how my girl Anne-Marie dealt with the pain of losing the love of her life, and the absolute rageful rampage she went on throughout this entire episode. And just, you know, that sad point where, you know, she was crying in Kurt's arms. Oh, man. Made me want to cry, man. Like I said in my review for episode 5, I hate seeing characters I love, especially my girl Anne-Marie, having to deal with those emotions. But, you know, it had to be done. But it also showed how much of a family the X-Men are, even more so, because, you know, they were all there for her. So that was good. And not to mention how the entire team and the mutants on Genosha that survived were dealing with the genocide, and how they were really awakened in seeing that maybe humanity isn't worth saving, and how the worst of humanity and the hate they brought allowed for this to happen, even if they weren't directly responsible. Which leads to the reveal of who was really responsible for the genocide, and it being none other than Bastion, played by my guy from the Divergent series, and a whole bunch of other films and shows, Theo James. As soon as I heard Bastion's voice, aka his voice, the Divergent series fan in me was awakened once again and ignited. And I couldn't be happier that he continues to get big roles like this. And he's genuinely really great as this character. He brought a really eerie and intimidating, yet calm and collected presence to the character that made him really stand out, and he did great. But regardless, the character himself was super keyed into everything, even knowing that Xavier was alive in space. He's really like if Obake was reincarnated. Not to mention how Cable came back, and for the first time, leading Scott to realize that he was his son. That was awesome. Episode 8, aka the start to one of the greatest three-part arcs in the entire show, Tolerance's Extinction, was genuinely incredible. It was more action-focused, but it was still amazing. Getting Bastion's backstory and seeing how far downhill he was going even since childhood. Him planning the genocide ever since he was a kid was crazy. Roberto having to deal with his mom being a bit of a cold and really irresponsible person and mother by letting the Sentinels take him and Jubilee and being collared. Also, Magneto being revealed to be alive and survived the genocide and trapped without clothes for some reason. Somebody get this guy some clothes, please. The Senator being revealed to be working with Bastion but regretting it after the events of what happened in Genosha. And the fight with the human Sentinels was absolutely incredible. 10 out of 10. Not to mention the beyond late return of Xavier. The only real nitpick I had was the fact that my girl Anne Marie was benched the entire episode. I know she was TKO'd the last episode, but come on, man. Oh, and how could I forget about the various appearances that happened once Magneto shut the world down? Although for those who know me and know this channel, you know the one that really mattered to me. Yes, my boy Spidey showed up. It was only for a grand total of 5 seconds, really leaning into the show's history of random cameos coming out of nowhere. But still, he might not be my favorite iteration of Peter in animation, that's the Spectacular Spider-Man, but the 90s Spider-Man is still awesome. And he's the one that had the profound pleasure of interacting with my girl Anne Marie. So yeah, he gets points for that at least. Episode 9, however, was even crazier. Once the team reunites, we see how much this season has really torn them apart. Which was really sad to see. Because when you look at how they used to be, you really see how much of a family they are. And how much they love each other. And to see them here, almost ready to break apart, it was really sad. My girl Anne Marie wakes up, still pissed, and especially pissed at Xavier. Kind of similar to how Hank was pissed at Xavier in Dark Phoenix.
Hank, it's your fault, Charles. It's your fault she's dead.
Come on, that's not fair.
Fair? No, no, talk about fair. You messed with the mind of an 8-year-old girl. You pushed down all that pain and anger. Where do you think it's gonna go?
I did that to help her. What I do
to help. Oh, please, come on, please. You still can't see what you did wrong?
It's just...
No, you need to face this, Charles. You need to face it. Come on, admit it to me right now. Come on.
Admit it.
Which leads me to talk about how misguided Charles can be, like a lot. I wouldn't say it's his fault that this whole thing happened, because whether he came back immediately after Landra healed him, or things played out the same, I believe that it still would have happened either way. Although if he was there, maybe they could have done more to stop Bastion and them from creating the three-headed master mold in the first place. It's kind of crazy how that is. But once Magneto comes in, and with Asteroid M, mind you, and provides everyone the choice to side with him in what is the most reasonable Magnus has ever sounded, my girl Anne Marie was quick to side with him. And honestly, that does make sense. I can see why people would be a bit conflicted with the choices my girl Anne Marie has made this season, especially because of everything she went through in the prior seasons. But besides the whole relationship with Magnus, I think they did a great job of really showing you why she's making these choices, instead of them just making her do these things blindly. Also, her siding with Magnus still adds to her arc of choosing to stand for something greater, even if this time it was for a darker purpose, and under darker circumstances. And again, I'm biased, so you know I'm gonna side with her either way. I'm just saying, you know that's gonna be the outcome. But regardless, it also made sense for Alberto to choose Magnus as well, because of how his own mother backstabbed him. But it was still sad to see. What wasn't sad to see, though, was the team going back to their OG outfits. That was awesome. It was also really cool to see that Scott progressively was able to become the father that his couldn't be. Even though I've been on record saying that I don't like the original Phoenix Sagas this show did, that has been one of the strongest after effects of it, in terms of Scott's character arc. And it was cool to get that diss to the original X-Men movie by Scott. I love the movies, and I always will, but that diss was earned, man. And after that was just pure chaos. Everyone fighting each other, the gold team starting to lose to Bastion and Mr. Sinister, the blue team having to fight my girl Anne Marie and Roberto while trying to stop Magnus from letting the world die, Cable being brainwashed to kill / incapacitate Jean while Scott watches, Magnus's mind being infiltrated by Xavier, Scott stopping Xavier, Magnus as a result almost killing Xavier, Logan almost killing Magnus, and Magnus pulling what has got to be the most savage and brutal TKO ever. I mean, that was crazy, man. It also shows how much he's been holding back this whole time. And then episode 10, the final episode of the season, and the Tolerance's extinction arc, where the X-Men have reconciled. My girl Anne Marie and Roberto go back to the X-Men after seeing the craziness Magnus unleashed upon Logan. Gold Team being absolutely defeated by Bastion, who is a complete cyborg now, and Sinister, with them unleashing the human sentinels onto the world, leading to the appearances in this episode, which were yet again crazy. You had the Avengers doing absolutely nothing to help the X-Men as usual. You had Daredevil show up. Cloak and Dagger! Oh my god. When they showed up, I almost leapfrogged off my couch. Not only that, but they look absolutely amazing. Marvel Studios, you better bring back the MCU Cloak and Dagger. I'm just saying, please and thank you. As well as Black Panther and Doctor Strange, which it was cool to see them dealing with these as well. Until Jean pops out as Phoenix and stops it all in its tracks and strips Sinister's powers away. That was something to behold. And the fact that this was the first time where Cable addresses Jean as his mother, and Jean addresses him as her son. Amazing. Absolutely incredible. But then Bastion comes back and attacks Cable, rips his arm off, and uses it to turn himself into the ultimate Bastion, in which he flies up to Asteroid M to take his power core, in which my girl Anne Marie takes her vengeance on Bastion. And it was glorious. Absolutely glorious, let me tell you. Just like my girl America before this, and Supersonic before that, it was an absolutely amazing thing seeing this, and cathartic after all the crap that she's went through this season. But Roberto also comes in to help her, officially donning the name Sunspot as well. And while they try their best, and of course my girl Anne Marie gets some very big hits in Incredible Hulk who? I'm just saying. They unfortunately are not able to stop him. The rest of the X-Men take him on, and they mostly don't stand a chance until Scott and Jubilee come in and absolutely wreck him. Then Beast and Jean, and Beast, Jean, and Aurora come in and stomp on him with a Sentinel, which was hilarious and great to see the family reunite. But this next moment is where the X-Men really came back together. Even though Bastion quite clearly being the most taxing villain they've ever faced, after everything he's done to them, they still try to show him a better way, a better path. This is why I love this version of the X-Men. Because after everything they've been through, after everything humanity has done to make their lives harder, they still fight for the greater good. They still fight for the safety, stability, and peace of a world that hates and fears them. That shows quite possibly why they're the greatest heroes in all of Marvel, actually. As much as I love the Fantastic Four, as much as I love, you know, my big four, even though my girl Anne Marie, technically, you know, she's a part of the X-Men, so I don't know if that counts. But as much as I love a lot of heroes in Marvel, especially, like I said, the Fantastic Four, it really shows why the X-Men are definitively, undisputably, the greatest heroes in all of Marvel. And it is absolutely shown here and put on full display. Although it doesn't work. When Asteroid M blows up because humanity was stupid enough to fire missiles at it, Asteroid M, the entirety of Asteroid M and everything comes crashing down, and Bastion takes the opportunity to take his own life. In the final moments between that Scott and Jean have talking to Cable was really heartfelt and emotional. We rarely ever see this vulnerable side to Cable in the series, so seeing it here was really meaningful. And seeing Scott's eyes, oh my goodness, that was something. I just really love what this show has done for Scott and Jean. They've come so far as characters up to this point, and it really makes this moment equally as impactful when you look at it from their perspective as well. In the final minutes of the episode, the X-Men trying to stop Asteroid M from crashing into Earth was really intense. The heroes on Earth still doing nothing, of course. But it was also cool having these moments between Xavier and Magnus in Magnus's mindscape. The idea of Magnus being reminded of his family, his past, why he chose to become the man he is, and what led him to it. And him coming back as Magneto was really well done and very well written. And then the ending. Everyone thinking the day is saved, my girl Anne Marie's gleeful smile that keeps me going every day. The world cheering in celebration, and then, poof, they're gone. When I saw that for the first time, I was very confused. Although some people said that because Bastion absorbed Cable's arm that had his time travel technology in it, that's what caused that explosion of sorts to happen. And I guess that would be a plausible explanation. But I guess we'll see what official explanation Season 7 gives. Then, we catch up with Forge, 6 months later, and him looking for them as well as other mutants, and almost giving up in a sense. However, Bishop finally comes back after being gone since the third episode, and thus starts the bond that Bishop and Forge have that we've seen since the beginning. As they get ready to go find the X-Men with a new team potentially. Then we see my girl Anne Marie waking up in a desert calling for anyone, and as soon as I saw that text come up, I was like,
"Oh shit, here we go again."
We see her fighting off a bunch of guys, and then Kurt comes out of nowhere, just as confused as she is. Then we see Scott and Jean in the far future, dealing with a young Nathan, aka Cable, which that was crazy. And whoever that Ascani lady is, I guess we'll find out in Season 7. And then as my girl Anne Marie, Kurt, Hank, Xavier, and Magnus see this masked man fighting, they ask who he is, and it's revealed that he is En Sabinur, aka Young Apocalypse, as they leave us off with the promise of yet another Apocalypse arc. Then we get an end credits tease of Apocalypse in the present day in Genosha, getting ready to bring back Remy as the Horseman Death. And that's it. That's Season 6. Believe it or not, I'm still on my first point. But that goes to show how excellent the story progression in the show truly is. It's very seamless and stays true to what made previous seasons so special. Not to mention how it respectfully adapts these comic storylines and treats them with care and sincerity, while at the same time taking the liberties necessary to make it work for these iterations of the characters. It's masterfully done, and still cements why this show is the greatest and most definitive X-Men story in all of media. The second reason is the characters. I already went over it earlier, but they all had amazing arcs this season that added to their overall trajectory and developments for the series as a whole. The arc with my girl Anne Marie scared me for a bit, pre-episode 5, but they really pulled through. They really pulled through for my girl and gave her something special, so I appreciate them for that. And my third and final point is the respect and the love put in. This is what makes this show and almost all Marvel anime media stand apart from live action media, especially. Maybe besides a majority of the Disney XD era, but besides that, the love and care that was put into this season. These characters, especially with this season being their grand return, and the stories they were given, cannot go without being commended once again. The people who made this season what it is, love these characters, love this show, and did everything in their power to do these characters justice. And that's what matters at the end of the day. That's ultimately what makes this season stand out. And that, along with literally everything involved, is why X-Men Season 6 is as great as it is. I don't know if it tops Season 4 for me, it probably doesn't still. But regardless, it is not only one of the best seasons of this show I've seen since Season 4, but it is one of the greatest seasons of television I've seen in the last decade. Since the absolute legends like Fullmetal Alchemist, Ben 10, She-Ra, and many more. And this season only cemented this show's place as one of, if not the greatest mainline superhero shows of all time. And with that, those are my thoughts on Season 6. I'm really looking forward to Season 7 with this new Apocalypse arc that's coming, and Season 8, whatever that'll end up being about. And I continue to be glad every day that this show exists and that is in my life now. So yeah, I am Jayan Haidar, aka SpideyFan101, saying peace.